Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we're studying the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular lesson is the first of a new series on the book of Proverbs. This lesson will be studied by Sabbath School members around the world on January 3 of 2015. And we hope that you got your Bible ready because there's a lot of references that we're going to look at back and forth through Scripture, not just at Proverbs, although it'll be primarily about Proverbs. But before we actually jump into this lesson entitled The Call of Wisdom, we'd like to ask you to pray with us as we try to understand God's Word. Our kind and wonderful Father, we thank you for this bit of old-fashioned wisdom found in the middle of Scripture. Help us to understand why it's here, what we can learn from it, and something about the people who wrote it down so that we could enjoy it. May that be our privilege today as our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. Where did the book of Proverbs come from? Well, that's a good question. It's not a simple question because you read verses like 1 Kings 4:32, and you read something like this. Talking about Solomon, if you look up here, it's talking all about his experiences and so forth. And you come down to 32, he composed 3,000 proverbs and more than 1,000 songs. So now, you people with the really fast brains, I'm going to ask you, how many songs from Solomon do we have in the Bible?
Not aware of any.
Well, of course, their songs were a little different than ours, but there are probably two. The Song of Solomon, and one of the Psalms, I think it's 101, something like that. I've forgotten the exact number. I think we have two that are in the Bible. So we don't know what happened to those other 1,000, or whether that's a round number or anything. We just don't know what happened to the rest of the songs. So now, the more practical question for our discussion today, if he composed 3,000 Proverbs, how many of those do we have? No, that's something that not many people know. Somewhere over about 550, somewhere around like that. And, of course, when I say that, I'm giving you the number of Proverbs that are in the book of Proverbs, and some of those didn't come from him. So we don't know exactly how many. So the next question that comes is, where are the rest of them, right?
Lost in antiquity.
Lost in antiquity?
Those are the ones that weren't inspired.
I see. Well, that was the question I wanted to ask. Is it possible that Solomon had some inspired proverbs and others that were not inspired?
Sure. It could be that the person who chose to leave them out was inspired because we've got enough here already.
I see. So that raises the next question. What about some of the book of Job and some of the Psalms? Wouldn't they qualify as Proverbs? Of course, you're going to ask me, and I should ask you, what is a proverb?
Yeah, what is a proverb?
I already asked you.
A witty saying.
It's a witty saying, and in ancient thinking, it was often either contrasting two things or comparing them, they're similar. So that was very often the case.
One word, advice.
Yeah, short period. What about the golden rule? Should that be a proverb?
Yeah.
Matthew 7, verse 12, remember that one? Do for others what you want them to do for you. This is the meaning of the law of Moses and the teachings of the prophets. Doesn't that sound like a good proverb? Good idea?
Were these proverbs a kind of, what's the word I'm looking for, kind of a fad at this time? And the reason I ask that, you know, in the stories of Samson, mm-hmm. they had these riddles.
Mm-hmm.
And if you could solve a riddle, then you could, I don't know, you get a prize or something like that. You don't see a whole lot of that. I'm just kind of wondering, maybe in the time of Samson, if that was kind of a fad or a trend or something that people did. And I'm I'm just kind of wondering if in the time of Solomon it wasn't. These little sayings were not kind of a fad.
So let me read, before I answer your question, let me read a few comments that have been made about the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs gives clear evidence of multiple authorship, as does the book of Psalms. This is because both of these Old Testament books are collections of writings. Solomon is believed to have written a tribute to wisdom, Proverbs 1:9-1 through 9:18. That's a special section of the first, initial section of the book of Proverbs. His first collections of sayings, Proverbs 10:1 to 22:20-16, and his second collection of sayings, which would have been inserted during the time of King Hezekiah. And if you look at Proverbs 25, verse 1, you'll notice it says, here are more of Solomon's Proverbs, they claim to be from Solomon, copied by men at the court of King Hezekiah of Judah. How long was the period between Solomon and Hezekiah? Anyone like to venture a guess?
A couple hundred years, 300 years.
About 300 years. Yeah. It is suggested that this last section, Proverbs 22:17 to 24:34, consists of Proverbs that Solomon collected from additional wisdom literature. So maybe he didn't write all those, or maybe even none at all. He collected them. Finally, Proverbs 30, verses 1 to 33, the chapter 30, is introduced by Agur, son of Jacob, and Proverbs 31, 1 to 31, is introduced by King Lemuel. And maybe we just need to read this, because there's something very, we'll talk about this later. Notice this, Proverbs 31, these are the solemn words which King Lemuel's mother said to him. How many other parts of Scripture do we have written by women?
Not much. Try zero.
Yeah, not much, yeah.
As far as we know, none. Now, there's some women who talk, and their words are recorded. But as far as writing any parts of Scripture, there's no evidence that any other women wrote any. So we're going to pay special attention to this when we get to the end of the book. Okay.
So, by the way, where did that paragraph that you read come from?
That was from a commentary on the book of Proverbs by G.H. Everett. He does a great job of looking at external sources and putting things together, so that's why I chose to quote from him.
The one thing I was wondering about Proverbs, do you ever get a proverb that somebody says and you say, are you sure that's true? I mean, proverbs are kind of a putting into words a truth that everybody kind of knows. Mm-hmm. It's like putting it into a small capsule of words, and then you read it and you say, oh, yeah, that's right. It's not really something that you come up and say, well, I don't know this. I've never seen this before. Are you sure it's true?
Yeah.
So,
but we're going to find a lot of proverbs that are generally true, but you can think of times when they're not true.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of thematic.
Mm-hmm.
Those of us have had children, there are tenets of stuff in here that you pass on to your kids,
mm-hmm.
and hope they pass them on to theirs.
And I can tell you, more than once, I've been in church services where people quote Proverbs, and they're really from Poor Richard's Almanac.
Okay. there's almost a prophetic kind of thing to it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I just looked at one here, and it's talking about being delivered from the forbidden woman, from the adulteress with her smooth words. I mean, it goes right down, and you think, boy, that's almost out of Daniel or Revelation.
Yeah.
In this paragraph that you read, it talks about the additional wisdom literature. What is that?
Oh, well.
What is that? Where Solomon collected these from?
From the Egyptian.
There was wisdom literature written. Egypt was famous for it. Edom was famous for it. The Arabian Peninsula was famous for it. There's some from Mesopotamia, and some later from Persia in later times. Wisdom literature was a big thing.
So if Solomon was collecting this from Egyptians and Hittites or whoever he collected them from. Mm-hmm. How come? Why was he decided he was going to collect all of this stuff?
Because
is this just a hobby, or
maybe
it was kind of fun for him, or?
But that, so this, and your question is a fair one, but it raises the next question: would we call that kind of stuff inspired?
Could be inspiring.
Being a king, he probably had plenty of spare time.
What do you mean by inspired? I still don't know what you mean.
Well, that's one of the first things we want to talk about. So it seems clear from Proverbs 25:1 that the final edit of the book of Proverbs was completed during the reign of Hezekiah between 729 and 686 BC, so plus or minus the year 700. Solomon himself reigned from 970 to 930 BC, so that's where we get our more or less 300 years. His Proverbs were almost certainly written or collected during the early part of that reign. If you remember something about Solomon's life, a little later he got so busy with women he probably didn't have time to collect Proverbs. Proverbs is primarily a book of practical wisdom. And here's a comment from the short paragraph sort of summarizing Proverbs from the introduction to Proverbs in Peterson's Message Bible. Many people think that what's written in the Bible has mostly to do with getting people into heaven, getting right with God, saving their eternal souls. It does have to do with that, of course, but not mostly. It is equally concerned with living on this earth, living well, living in robust sanity. In our scriptures, heaven is not the primary concern, to which earth is a tag-along afterthought. On earth as it is in heaven is Jesus' prayer. Wisdom is a biblical term for this on earth as it is in heaven, everyday living. So there's one definition of wisdom, okay? Wisdom is the biblical term for this on earth as it is in heaven, everyday living. Wisdom is the art of living skillfully in whatever actual conditions we find ourselves. It has virtually nothing to do with information as such, with knowledge as such. A college degree is no certification of wisdom, nor is it primarily concerned with keeping us out of moral mud puddles, although it does have a profound moral effect upon us. Wisdom has to do with becoming skillful in honoring our parents and raising our children, handling our money and conducting our sex lives, or sexual lives, going to work and exercising leadership, using words well and treating friends kindly, eating and drinking healthily, cultivating emotions within ourselves and attitudes toward others that make for peace. Threaded through all these items is the insistence that the way we think of and respond to God is the most practical thing we do. In matters of everyday practicality, nothing, absolutely nothing, takes precedence over God. Proverbs concentrates on these concerns more than any other book in the Bible. Attention to the here and now is everywhere present in the stories and legislation, the prayers and the sermons that are spread over the thousands of pages of the Bible. Proverbs distills it all into riveting images and aphorisms that keep us connected in the holy obedience to the ordinary. So what do you learn from those words? What's an aphorism?
Proverb.
Yeah, another word for proverb, yeah.
Somewhat descriptive of the way things work, or cause and effect, mm-hmm. and it's looking forward, and it's really what the Ten Commandments are. It's mm-hmm. really a description of the way things will be if the creation is going to function properly.
Yeah.
You know, there are some things in the Bible that are there to show us or an example of human folly.
Mm-hmm.
And these are kind of, in a way, regardless of how wise they might be, they are kind of little ditties, so to speak. How do we know that these aren't here for that very purpose? How do we know that Solomon, we do know that it's generally Christian understanding and thought that Solomon kind of wasted some of his time. How do we know these aren't here as an example that Solomon really should have been spending his time leaving us greater pieces of literature?
Yeah.
Good question. Well, how did Solomon get all his wisdom? Because that's one of the questions we need to talk about.
He prayed. Didn't he pray for it?
Remember, he was a young man. He didn't expect to be in charge of the government at such a young age. And he went from Jerusalem down to, I think it was Gibeah. And there he was praying to the Lord. That was the place where the temple was located, the tabernacle was located at that point. And God appeared to him in a dream and said, ask what you want. And what did he ask for? He didn't ask for long life. He didn't ask for wealth. He didn't ask for conquering all his enemies. He asked for wisdom to judge God's people. And God says, because you did this, I'll give you all the others.
It's probably the wisest thing he ever did.
Yeah.
Well, doesn't that, when you say he didn't ask for all those things, don't you think he was smart enough to know that if he had wisdom, he would get all those things?
Well, maybe he was smart enough to know that afterwards.
Well, I don't know. It's kind of like, what's that?
You would have had to have been humble to ask for wisdom.
Humble to ask for wisdom, but still, if you kind of knew that a wise person lives long, a wise person is usually rich, the wise person is usually all those things that everybody thanks him or holds him up because he didn't ask for them, but yet wisdom has it built in.
He was pretty smart to begin with, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
But he asked, remember, he specifically asked for a wise heart. And the Hebrew actually says, a listening heart to judge your people. That's what he asked for. Yes?
But you could almost say, in a sense, he was set up, because when he got wealthy, then he started running around and carrying on. So he had more stuff to resist because of that.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's another thing. Ellen White, off and on, talks about human wisdom. Mm-hmm. Now, that's still wisdom. But for some reason, it seems to be lacking God.
Well, so she talks about divine wisdom, too.
That's right. That's right. And that's my point, that if you talk about wisdom, it does not necessarily mean that it's the wisdom of God. It could be the wisdom of men. And even us would look at the wisdom of men and think that would still be pretty good.
Yeah.
Along the line of what Carrie said, perhaps it would have been wiser for God, do I dare say that, to not give Solomon all that power and all that wealth so that he would...
Now, you better be careful. You're going to blame God for what Solomon did?
No, but you can't help but look.
Well,
he
takes responsibility, so yeah. It's okay.
In that sense, yes.
If he didn't have all the wealth and power and so on, would he have spent all his time on women and drinking and so on?
Yeah.
I don't know. But getting back to what you were saying, whether wisdom is wisdom, God blessed wisdom is obviously the best way to go, but the Bible also says, honor the hoary head. And that's because they're older and they're experienced and they've got wisdom, hopefully with God influencing it.
Yeah.
You know, it could be argued that the fact that there is so much wisdom here, in comparison to what we understand Solomon did with some of his life, it looks like that he was nevertheless blessed with wisdom in the short period of time that we would say he used it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, exactly. Well, it's interesting to notice that some of his proverbs bear a striking resemblance to a book, not really a book, some writings known as the Wisdom of Menemophis, written down about the same time that Solomon wrote down his books in Egypt. Scholars are divided about whether maybe Menemophis borrowed it from Solomon or Solomon borrowed it from Menemophis, but everybody recognizes that what they both had is something that was generally recognized as being wise statements from quite a long time earlier. So maybe both these guys got it from somebody further back that we don't know who it was or where.
Maybe it was in that big library in where? Alexandria?
Alexandria.
Yes.
Well, that was, these guys lived
long before.
Long before that, yeah.
Still, you don't know.
Well, does this raise any questions in your mind about maybe we should be cutting the Proverbs out of the Bible because they're not inspired?
Well,
I don't think so.
that depends on how we are defining inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe our perception of inspiration is too narrow or too limited or too specific if we were to take mm-hmm. that.
You mean like infallible?
No, I'm saying maybe we don't get as much out of inspiration. Maybe Gordon is far more inspired than I give him credit for, simply because I have limited what I'm willing to accept for inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think you can say there's no inspiration here in Proverbs 3.
Yeah.
The Lord's curse is on the house of the wicked. Mm-hmm. So it goes on. So there's inspiration in it here and there at least.
Mm-hmm. Well, and the New Testament writers apparently thought that Proverbs was inspired because they quoted several times. Proverbs 3, 11 and 12 is quoted in Hebrews 12, 5 and 6, and Proverbs 3, 34 is quoted in James 4, 6 and 1 Peter 5, 5. Two different New Testament authors quoted that one. Proverbs 11, 31 is quoted in 1 Peter 4, 18. Proverbs 25, 21 and 22 is quoted in Romans 12, 20. And Proverbs 26, 11 is quoted in 2 Peter 2, 22. Now, if you want to have all that information and you can't write it down as fast as I spoke it, you're welcome to go to our website, which is www.theox.org for nonprofit organization, O-R-G. And there you will find our handout for this Sabbath School lesson, which you're welcome to use at liberty and much or a little of it as you like in your Sabbath School class. So
just because it's used in the New Testament, then therefore that means the Old Testament is inspired. So maybe these people were just as wrong as to.
So now you're going to question the inspiration of all of Scripture.
Well, that's what we're doing here. we're asking what's inspired and what isn't inspired. Mm-hmm. So just because the New Testament fellows used it, mm-hmm. doesn't necessarily mean, let us say, that they should have been using it. Couldn't that be an argument? I mean, we're saying, well, the Old Testament's got to be good because the New Testament guys used it. So that proves it.
Okay, well, here's the story behind wisdom. Yes, Gordon.
As I recall, the story of Lazarus and the rich man mm-hmm. was supposed to be a story from
Egypt.
So that the New Testament quotes that, even Jesus quoted it, or related to it, does that mean that that was inspired?
And yeah, wouldn't we be better off without that story?
Couldn't
I think it's created more confusion as far as Adventists are concerned.
The other way, what is not inspired in it?
Yeah. Well, here's where the story, all this Proverbs kind of stuff apparently came from. I'm quoting 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 5 and following. That night, the Lord appeared to him, Solomon, this is, in a dream, and asked him, "What would you like me to give you?" Solomon answered, "You always showed great love for my father David, your servant, and he was good, loyal, and honest in his relations with you. And you have continued to show him your great and constant love by giving him a son who today rules in his place. O Lord God, you have let me succeed my father as king, even though I am very young and don't know how to rule. Here I am among the people you have chosen to be your own, a people who are so many that they cannot be counted. So give me the wisdom I need to rule your people with justice and to know the difference between good and evil. Otherwise, how would I ever be able to rule this great people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this, and so he said to him, "Because you have asked for the wisdom to rule justly instead of long life for yourself or riches or the death of your enemies, I will do what you have asked. I will give you more wisdom and understanding than anyone has ever had before or will ever have again. I will also give you what you have not asked for all your life. You will have health and wealth and honor, more than any other king. And if you obey me and keep my laws and commands as your father David, I will give you a long life." That's a pretty, I mean, what would you do if God promised you that?
More wisdom than anybody will ever have?
Well, I just read to you what it says.
The e-ticket to life.
But what about Jesus?
Yeah.
Did he even beat Jesus as far as wisdom goes?
No.
No, there's no way.
Well, is it possible for God to give a wisdom implant?
Well, if he created it,
sure.
Why not?
If he decides to do that, he can.
Yeah.
How would you do it? How would your thing? Okay, here I am. I'm sleeping alongside Solomon, and God says, "Bang! He just gave me a wisdom implant." How would my thinking be different now?
Well, maybe it wasn't bang. Maybe it grew and grew and grew.
Well, God gave people language implants.
Yeah.
So there isn't much difference, is there?
Maybe God gave him access to, or is exposed to, other smart people in his time. I'm sure there were others.
Well, if you go to the book of Ecclesiastes, which we will not be studying particularly, but we'll refer to once in a while, which Solomon wrote near the end of his life, he talks about all the different things that he studied.
Yes, so there's knowledge elsewhere.
Yeah. Well, from the time of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, true wisdom has been all about making right choices. Eve and later Adam chose to eat the fruit from the tree and gain the knowledge that Satan wanted them to have, the knowledge of evil. And all the rest of us have followed that pattern, Romans 5. And now I quote from Ellen White, The Book Education, page 25, "Man lost all because he chose to listen to the deceiver rather than to him who is truth, who alone has understanding. By the mingling of evil with good, his mind had become confused." So what is Satan's prize weapon?
Evil, I guess.
Mingling evil with good. Yes. Satan doesn't come to us with straight evil. Most of us would be able to figure it out if it was straight evil. Satan's trick is to try to mingle evil with good so that you think you're getting good and you get some evil mixed in, and pretty soon you think the evil is pretty good stuff and you become confused.
It's deception, and that's what the book of Revelation says, the deceiver of the whole world.
Yeah. Well, there's a famous passage.
So wisdom doesn't hold you back from deception.
Well, it should, as much as possible, yes.
Well, that means Adam and Eve didn't have wisdom at all.
They had knowledge, but not much in the way of wisdom. They weren't very wise in terms of making right choices.
Why is that?
Well, I mean, what would you want God to do? I mean, let's think about this. They had a relatively brief experience. They had not been exposed to anybody who lied to them or deceived them or anything like this. All their experience was people you could trust 100%. Fruit was all lovely. Never had any problem with any diseases or anything from any of that. So, I mean, you know, what did you want the God to do? Come and say, "Look out, there's a snake in the tree over there," or, you know?
He did. But you're saying that they weren't prepared, and God put that tree there when they weren't prepared. So isn't that kind of...
No, God warned them about the tree.
I was going to say, we don't know that. We don't know exactly how long they were in there before they ran off the rails.
They were warned about the tree, but yet they didn't take the warning.
So they weren't wise.
They weren't wise.
Yes.
Okay, so if they weren't wise, why would God put a tree there?
Well...
Choice.
They were given choice.
The idea is to learn how to make right.
It's a choice, but when you make a choice, you got to have wisdom to make the choice.
Well, you don't have to have wisdom. You should have the wisdom. You should have wisdom, but how many choices do you make which aren't wise? Now, you don't have to confess, but.
Well, I mean, I'm not Adam and Eve that were created supposedly perfect.
Yeah. Isn't that the difference between knowledge and wisdom?
Yeah.
And they probably had some knowledge, but yes, they didn't have life experience, possibly.
And the Lord put the tree there with people that didn't have life experience.
What I'm getting at is there's a sort of a degree here, and if you keep looking at it long enough, you'll go out the back door of the church. There's some things you got to have with faith.
Well, there's a famous verse.
I heard Gary ask, well, God put the tree there, and I hear Jim saying it was for protection.
Mm-hmm.
So, Jim, maybe you better explain.
Well, God does everything in the open, so the adversary had opportunity, has to have the opportunity to tell his side of the story or to convince those that he can. He convinced a third in heaven. So then, rather than letting the adversary chase him all over the garden, round and round and round, he says, you're stuck there. They have
right
to get
in
on
the middle.
Right in the middle.
Right in fact, the middle of everything.
Right close to the tree
right
of knowledge.
They had to stay away from him and go around the perimeter of the place to stay away from him. Yeah. So God put it right in the middle. So that's kind of beyond me. I'm trying to figure that out.
Choice.
Choice is the way. Without choice, you don't have love.
Yeah.
And if God is love, he could only create intelligent creatures that have the capacity to make a choice.
But I don't go to a baby and say, don't put your finger in that light socket else you're going to.
I'll bet you did when your kids were small.
But God didn't. He put that tree there.
He warned them about it. The angels warned them about it.
I can't warn my baby that not to stick the finger in the finger thing because I would just take it away. But God didn't take it away. He left it there.
They were not tested beyond their ability.
So explain that.
These are babies.
Sooner or later.
They were just created. What do you mean they're not babies? We just said they didn't have the wisdom.
They were adult size. You got to make it.
Okay, size doesn't mean anything. Come on, you got to have the experience.
Adam was wise enough to name all of the animals.
Right.
And naming means you understand those animals. You describe something about them that's peculiar to that animal. So that's.
I don't understand that, but okay, I'll take what you said.
We're also assuming that that the tree was there, and every time they passed it, they would be tempted. It could be that once they were tempted and refused the temptation, then the temptation would not have been there all of the time.
Yeah,
maybe
possibly.
The serpent, maybe Satan would have said, okay, you know, you have to leave now. You can't stay here.
Well, they began to, the 10th commandment started to bother them. They started to want something that didn't belong to them.
Yeah.
And then they begin to, and the sin begins in your mind. The 10th commandment is where it all begins most of the time.
Well, there's a famous verse that's repeated in Proverbs. The first place it comes up is Proverbs 1, verse 7. Let's look at it a moment. To have knowledge, you must first have reverence for the Lord. Stupid people have no respect for wisdom and refuse to learn. Okay? What does that mean? Let me give you another version of it. It's found in Proverbs 9, verse 10, slightly different. Where it says, to be wise, you must first have reverence for the Lord. If you know the Holy One, you have understanding. Now, if you read one of the more traditional translations, let me look at the New American Standard Bible. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. What's the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom? Are we supposed to be afraid of God?
It's only the first step, but however, another way you could put it is to be in awe of God is the first step toward wisdom.
Okay.
It doesn't mean cowering and fear.
I like fear.
Mm-hmm.
I like that concept. It's the beginning of wisdom. A wise person heads toward God. And when one is separated from God, one finds himself in desperate circumstances, and he can find himself in fearful circumstances, and his inclination is to, when he is in these fearful circumstances, is to head toward God. What's the old saying? There's no atheists in foxholes. So, and if you're separated from God, you're in a fearful circumstance, and you recognize, I'm in trouble here, and the beginning of your wisdom is the thought to head toward God. I like the word fear here.
Okay, very good. But if you were scared to death of God, you wouldn't run toward God, you'd run away from him.
Well, we're reading into this that it's talking about being afraid of God.
Okay, well, let's look at...
Does it say the fear of God?
Yeah. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
And, of course, that means how do you interpret that? Is that God's fear that he puts in us, or is that fear of him, that we're afraid of him?
It's one of the major motivators. There's only two motivators primarily in life that are not related to love, and that is fear and greed. So,
well, if we go over to 1 John, now way over at the end of the New Testament, 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, it says, my children, the end is near. That would be our time, right? You were told that the enemy of Christ would come, and now many enemies of Christ have already appeared, and so we know that the end is near. And I wanted to back up just a little bit before I read that. And I'm sorry, I'm missing my verse here. Hold on. It's in here, 1 John here, and I'm sorry, I thought I had located it. A verse in 1 John which says, love casts out all fear. How can, if God is love and love casts out all fear, how can the fear of God be the beginning of wisdom? Isn't that a contradiction?
Well, like you have referenced here, that reverence and awe.
Yeah.
A better translate, but it's only a first step, but it is a step in the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not going to have respect or reverence for somebody that's not trustworthy. So you have to spend some time listening and taking instruction.
I was going to say you could put the meaning "listen" in there; it would fit too. Yeah.
Well, and what about this? Look at back to Exodus. Now we're going back before Solomon, several hundred years. On the morning, now here's the children of Israel. They have prepared for God to come down and speak to them, okay? They're gathered around the foot of that mountain. On the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning. A thick cloud appeared on the mountain, and a very loud trumpet blast was heard. All the people in the camp trembled with fear. Does that sound like a very congenial... I mean, did you suppose they wanted to run up and hug the mountain?
No. Burrow into the ground might be more appropriate in that case.
But the interesting thing is, if you look at what happened after God spoke to them, look at chapter 20, Exodus 20, starting with verse 18. And this is what happened. All the people, and this is, you know, this is right after the Ten Commandments. The seven up to 17 is the Ten Commandments. The very next verse says, all the people perceived the thunder and the lightning flashes and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when they saw it, they were trembled and stood at a distance. They were running away from God. Then they said to Moses, speak to us yourself and we will listen. But let not God speak to us or we will die. Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Isn't that the same as fear?
Yeah.
For God has come in order to test you. Now, if you go to the King James, which I probably should do right now, look at this. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, for God has come to prove you, and that his fear may be before your faces that ye sin not. Fear not, so that you may fear. What's that? What's going on there?
You know, back then, didn't kings kind of get their respect by being ruthless,
well,
scaring everybody?
Some did.
I think they all did, if you ask me. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no way that anybody would rise to power unless they were ruthless and people were scared of them. That's what it was. And it's kind of... If you ask me, I think that whole thing is in that culture right there, where the beginning of wisdom is fear.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's happening here. Once you get through the fear, well, then you start getting into the truth. And that's when...
When does the fear fade and the love start?
Well, it took a while.
Mm-hmm.
That's where trust comes in.
Yeah.
That's why you have to work out so to see if these proverbs work out.
Yeah,
just think what the Romans did to all the people that broke the laws there.
What about
Solomon?
I mean,
Solomon? they put them up, they crucified them, they put them up in front of everybody just to scare the daylights out of them.
Yeah.
How many of Solomon's relatives were killed before so Solomon could take his position?
Well, that's kind of like the Godfather, isn't it?
Well,
when he took over, he kind of got rid of David's enemies.
Well, fear, reverence. Fear, reverence, or awe of God should characterize every Christian who has an acute consciousness of God's personal presence at all times and everywhere. Practicing the presence of God was made famous by Brother Lawrence, a lay brother, and a Carmelite monastery in Paris who lived from approximately 1614 until 1691. His book, Practicing the Presence of God, is still popular in some circles. Is that what would lead us to fear God? What would it mean to us on a day-by-day basis to practice the presence of God? If we were constantly aware of God as being right beside us or right with us, how would it affect our day-by-day activities? The next time you're tempted to sin, if you think of God standing right beside you, would that impact you?
I think so. You'd be a lot more careful what you did.
I would think so. Surely God's wisdom incorporated into our thinking would help to protect us from falling into evil. So why do you think the Bible seems to use the word fear to describe anxiety and terror as well as respect and worship? Now, several of you have tried on that one. There's probably a spectrum from abject terror to full respect, and somewhere on that spectrum, each one of us is, right?
It's one of those English words that has a lot of different shades of meaning.
Well, of all the books in the Bible, Proverbs talks more about the fear of the Lord than any other. The idea that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge and especially wisdom is repeated several times in Scripture. It's not just in Proverbs. It's found also in Job 28, verse 28, and Psalm 111, verse 10. Look at Proverbs 3, verse 7. There's an interesting idea there. And we probably need to look at one of the more traditional translations first. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. What's the relationship between fearing the Lord and departing from evil?
That's where I think it's more listen, think about it. If you go back up to verse 5, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Mm-hmm.
It also says, do not lean on your own understanding.
Mm-hmm. If we thought that God was right next to us every moment, and then we think, okay, we want to respect and reverence God, wouldn't that incline us to shun evil?
Yeah.
I would think so. Have you ever tried living an entire day constantly aware of God's presence? How do you think it would impact your... Think of what happens in your day from morning, early in the morning to late at night.
It would influence all of your daily activities and all of your interrelationships with other people around you constantly.
Remember that God is our creator, sustainer, redeemer, and friend. And in his very essence is love, 1 John 4, 8, and 16. To know him is to love him. We believe that. That does not preclude the fact that we live in awe and reverence for him. The better we know him, the more awe, reverence, and love we should have for him. Do you have any problems with that idea? Well, how do we learn that kind of awe and reverence for God?
You know, those are just words.
Yes. But we talked earlier about the electric plugs in the house.
Mm-hmm.
You warn your kids, you warn them. You don't take their hand and say, try this.
No, but you don't leave them there by yourself either.
Yeah.
By themselves. And
I was going to say, on the same chapter 3, if you go down further to 11, it says, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline.
Mm-hmm.
Or be weary of his reproof, for the Lord reproves him whom he loves as a father, mm-hmm. the son in whom he delights. I mean, it answers your question and the comments on yours.
Yep.
Right there.
Well, and now I'm quoting from Ellen White, the book from an article she wrote in a magazine entitled The Pacific Union Recorder in 1910, where she says, in his wisdom, the Lord has decreed that the family shall be the greatest of all educational agencies. It is in the home that the education of the child is to begin. Here is his first school. Here with his parents as instructors, he is to learn the lessons that are to guide him throughout life. Does that sound like a place to learn about wisdom and knowledge? The educational influences of the home are a decided power for good or for evil. If the child is not instructed aright here, Satan will educate him through agencies of his choosing. That's a scary thought, isn't it? Well, here's what could be and should be the final conclusion of all of that. A well-ordered Christian household is a powerful argument in favor of the reality of the Christian religion, an argument that the infidel cannot gainsay. What does that mean?
Gainsay means kind of argue about it.
Yeah.
It's right there in front of you.
Yep.
Simple to see.
If you see a family where, you know, the children behave and they're respectful and they do what they're supposed to do, you think, well, I guess that happened by accident, right?
No.
No.
Gotta be taught.
That takes a lot of careful teaching. And some children are easier to teach than others. I obviously work in a clinic where we see a lot of children, and you can definitely tell that some of them haven't had much discipline. Well, everyone can see that they're reading on. All can see that there is an influence at work in the family that affects the children, and that the God of Abraham is with them. If the homes of professed Christians had a right religious mold, they would exert a mighty influence for good. They would indeed be the light of the world. You remember Matthew 5:16. The God of heaven speaks to every faithful parent in the words addressed to Abraham. Now I quote again, now Ellen White quoting the Bible, "I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him." Patriarchs and Prophets, page 144, paragraph 3.
Does that always happen?
Well, that's a good question. What do you think?
Well, there's Gordon's comment that he said that all the angels were raised in a perfect home, and then we had trouble with that.
A third of them rebelled.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And I think with children, it's the way it's done, not only by words. Example is a big one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The kid who watches his parents do something that they know they shouldn't do, and the kid watches, and you say to the kid, "Don't do that," and what is the kid learning?
I have an author that I like. He writes a lot of humorous essays, which are kind of proverbial. It's a fellow by the name of Robert Fogelman. I remember one of the comments he makes in his essays about parenting. He said, "Parents should fear less that their children are not doing what they tell them to do, and fear more that their children are watching them."
There it is.
There's a good comment. Well, to illustrate the true meaning of love, the most important thing that a father can do for his children is to love their mother. Would that be an illustration? Yeah. Time spent with our children will be of much greater value to them than anything we can do in our businesses or gifts we might give them or other things we might bestow upon them. So how can we teach our children to resist temptations that culture, society, friends, and even family might throw their way? Surely no one in our modern world doubts that we are surrounded by evil. How can we keep our focus on Jesus? That's the question, isn't it? Well, let's, after philosophizing for a bit, let's turn specifically to some passages in the book of Proverbs. Look at Proverbs 1, verse 11. Suppose they say, "Come on, let's find someone to kill. Let's attack some innocent people for the fun of it." And what will be the result? Verse 18 says, "But people like that are setting a trap for themselves, a trap in which they will die." Isn't that true? It was reported on the television just as I was leaving to come to the class this evening that more and more crimes are being solved by cameras that are just, you know, out there almost everywhere in streets and so forth like this. And this particular criminal thought, I'm sure he thought he could get away with what he did. He had tried to kidnap a young lady. But there were several cameras focused down that street, and boy, it was about 1 or 2 days, and they had nabbed him. So
it's telling on the times in which we live, though, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, look at Proverbs 1, verses 22 to 32. Foolish people, how long do you want to be foolish? How long will you enjoy pouring scorn on knowledge? Will you never learn? Listen when I reprimand you. I will give you your good advice. I will give you good advice and share my knowledge with you. This is the wisest man who ever lived, presumably, talking. I have been calling you, inviting you to come, but you would not listen. You paid no attention to me. You have ignored all my advice, and you have not been willing to let me correct you. So when you get into trouble, I will laugh at you. That sounds like a nice, loving, parenting thing to do, right? I will mock you when terror strikes. When it comes on you like a storm bringing fierce winds of trouble and you are in pain and misery, then you will call for wisdom, but I will not answer. You may look for me everywhere, but you will not find me. You have never had any use for knowledge and have always refused to obey the Lord. You have never wanted my advice or paid any attention when I corrected you. So then you'll get what you deserve and your own actions will make you sick. Inexperienced people die because they reject wisdom. Stupid people are destroyed by their own lack of concern. How does that sound?
Sounds like a God who is vengeful, unkind, and arbitrary.
But is it true that people get what they deserve?
But the next verse says, but whoever listens to me will dwell secure.
Well, what happens to people who choose the wrong path?
They get what they deserve.
Well, can you walk in the right path and the wrong path at the same time? Does doing evil have consequences?
Yeah, definitely.
Many modern educators and scholars in the media make fun of those who hold to religious beliefs. Christians are marked as simple and naive. But a careful look into the situation will show that those people have their own superstitions and crazy ideas. I mean, take just a simple, crazy example. The whole nation celebrates Halloween.
Yeah.
I mean, how stupid is that?
Yeah, but look at the monsters now. They all look cute.
Does that matter? Women look cute, too. That doesn't mean you need to celebrate everything they do.
That wasn't a good comparison there.
The other side of that coin is, as we speak right now, there's at least one, and there was two programs, were two, on TV dealing with what the kids make fun of. The real thing is being put on our TV.
Mm-hmm.
It's just staggering.
Huh? Well, at the end of the chapter says, but whoever listens to me will have security. He will be safe with no reason to be afraid. If you have the fear of the Lord, you have no reason to be afraid, right?
If I get what my just deserts are,
mm-hmm.
if I do a whole lot more good things and not so many little things, so fewer bad things, then I'm going to be better off, right?
Sounds like it. Proverbs suggests in the last few minutes we've got, Proverbs suggests that there's a three-step process to gaining wisdom. Do you remember what those are? Let me just review them for you. The first step is careful listening. People can be spouting all the wisdom in the world. If you're not listening, it's not going to help you a bit. That's number one. Second is, we need to have our ears open to God's words. We need to think about it. We need to recognize wisdom when it's spoken. Say, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. And then finally, we must value it as treasure and continue to search for more. That's the way we make the best use of wisdom. Is it true that as we come to know God, we will know more clearly than ever the right path in which to walk? Isn't that what's supposed to happen when we get to know God? We will develop a greater sense of righteousness, justice, and fairness. Could we actually come to the place where we enjoy doing what is right? Well,
most of the time.
What we're striving for.
Yeah. There's some very interesting passages that I would encourage. We don't have time to read them now. Christ Object Lessons, the bottom of page 99 and a little bit on the top, I'm sorry, 97, a little on top of 98, and especially Desire of Ages, page 668, paragraph 3, that are very relevant to this question. Well, what is one of the first things that happens when we are led astray and fall into evil? Proverbs says in Proverbs 2, verse 13, those who have abandoned a righteous life to live in the darkness of sin. So what's one of the first things that happens? We're living in darkness. Who is faithful to her own husband? I'm sorry. Let me get back here. Yeah, verse 17. Who is faithless to her own husband and forgets her sacred vows. If you go to her house, you're traveling the road to death. To go there is to approach the world of the dead. That's exciting, huh? So the first step in doing evil is turning away from God's guidance for our lives, right? How many of us actually enjoy sinning? I won't ask anybody to answer that personally. Why do we sin? Is it because we enjoy it for one reason or another?
You're talking about actions there, aren't you? I thought sinning was being away from God.
Thoughts lead to actions.
Everything begins in the mind and the imagination. I think sometimes it's subconsciously there's an inner need that we're trying to satisfy, and so we march off in this strange direction.
Does that work, though, when you're with God? Does that inner need make you sin when you're with God?
I'm gonna read one more area really quick because we're about out of time. Proverbs 3, 19 and 20 suggests that, and let me just look at it that, the Lord created the earth by his wisdom, by his knowledge he set the sky in place, his wisdom caused the rivers to flow and the clouds to give rain to the earth. And New Testament writers pick that up and suggest that we live, we move, we have our existence. Ellen White talks about it repeatedly, Mount of Blessing, 74, paragraph 3. God is the creator, sustainer, ruler, basis for all living things. So wouldn't you think that someone who had that power that did all of that would be the right person who could guide us in the right way to live? Especially young people, shouldn't they recognize that God wants what is best for them? Our kind and loving Father, we thank you for being with us through our first hour of discussion. May those who watched gain some blessing from what we've had to say, and may it be to them an opportunity to think more clearly about the subject of wisdom, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.